to order the Committee on Legislative Matters meeting for March 13th, 2017. And we got our, we've taken our roll so that we're.
Counselor Murphy?
I'm here.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Here.
Counselor Shara?
Here.
Counselor Nash?
Here.
All right, and we're going to first approve the meeting minutes from February 13th. Everybody?
Move to approve.
Second.
Any discussion, alterations? Hearing none? All in favor?
Aye.
And then what we're going to do, since the public hearing is set for 5:30, is jump to some of our other business that we have to do. And the first thing would be 17.233, an ordinance relative to school zones. It was referred to this committee in January, but it hadn't had time to get through transportation and parking before now, so now it's back. And Counselor O'Donnell is the chair of that committee, so would you, you're the sponsor and the chair, so if you want to go through it with us, that'd be great.
The Transportation Park Commission gave it a unanimous favorable recommendation. That's what I have to report. I mean, I could explain it again, although I think I've explained it twice in two separate meetings in this committee. But I could answer any questions. Two new documents relative to the three new school zones that would be created in the expansion of the Bridge Street school zone. I have maps for each. If the committee wants to review the maps to see exactly where they are, they've been prepared by the DPW. That's available if the committee wants to see it.
What's the committee's pleasure? I know you.
Some I've of you. I've experienced this many times.
You've experienced it many times, and you're good with it. How about Councilor Nash? Are you?
I'm good.
I mean, you're in your happy place too with it. With 17.233.
We can show them in council or something.
Okay.
I do have them here too. Wait, here they all are.
And if you want, for fun, there's a lot of people ask all legal questions about this, like why can't we put a school zone around daycares and things like that. There's a one-page document that I made, which is all the rules about the school zones, which are in state law and state regulations, and you can see each of the sources for each criteria.
Yeah, what starts at K and ends at 8, right, as I recall?
Yeah. No, it starts at 1.
1. Okay, so grade 1 through 8 can have a school zone,
right, yes.
Not high schools, not preschools.
Yeah. So anyway, so that's for your reference and to answer any constituent questions if you get.
And this will be back on Thursday and you get to explain it one more time.
Exactly. Should it pass today.
All right. Well, Councilor Nash.
I have a quick question. So, because we talked about this before, I don't know where it landed, but Heck Academy on Pleasant Street was requesting possibly to be one of the school zones.
Okay. I didn't hear from them directly, but
okay.
You heard that from them.
I heard that from them.
What are their grades?
You know, they sometimes have 7th and 8th graders, but they tend to be high school. So
I guess I would say that, you know, the zones we're creating don't preclude further
additions.
School zones in the future, so you can certainly revisit it.
So the other thing I was thinking is there's going to be all the upgrades on Pleasant Street anyway,
exactly, yeah.
So that's going to be much more than a school zone. They're going to have the upgrades on the crosswalks there, so, you know.
Yeah, arguably the improvements you would want for that part of downtown would be like 24/7 somewhere. And that's 25 miles an hour in downtown business anyway.
Right.
But certainly something we can talk about.
Okay.
You know, with your knowledge of that institution, we can bring up the Transportation Parking Commission or whoever you thought was best, and we can talk about it.
All right, I'll talk to them.
I don't know the answer. Okay.
Yeah.
Do you know, I mean, again, maybe this is not the right time to talk about it, but the entrance to it, where is it? Because that's one of the regulations that it needs to be like sort of fronted on the street now.
It needs to be on the right of way in which you're putting a school zone, and children have to cross to get there.
Right, and most of their kids are actually delivered there by van, but they go out and do internships and stuff during the day. So they do cross the street. But it wouldn't, it's not, you know, it would be at that noontime release time.
Okay. Yeah, it's an interesting question. It seems like there's a lot of variables that I'd have to explore, but definitely willing to explore it.
Okay, I'll talk to Bill and.
Okay, yeah, please, and I'm happy to join any meetings or conversations about it.
Excellent.
Okay.
Thanks.
So now we're set with that. Somebody want to come up with a motion on the school zone?
With a positive recommendation.
Second?
Second.
Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any not in favor? I don't know who that would be, since we're all in favor. All right, and that really is our only piece of business until it gets to be 5:30 and everyone else shows up to do the public hearing.
Adjourn or recess?
Actually, I thought I might run something by you unrelated to this committee. Because I've been actually thinking about the study request from finance. And a couple of us are in finance here. My thought on the, another way to do the budget hearings, because they're prior, the budget hearings that you're talking about are ones prior to the public hearing at council when the mayor presents the budget. So they're the ones that precede his actual presenting of the budget in formal council. And one of the reasons, from my experience, that they don't really get well attended is that they're kind of really awkward. They run for several days. Sometimes not all the councilors can be there. That it's done in a very chopped up and time consuming fashion. What I might suggest, and I'll do this at council on Thursday, but I thought I'd throw it out so you can think about it a little bit, that we do that portion of the budget hearings only with the mayor and the finance director. They know these department budgets as well as department heads do. And we do the five large departments all at one time. We save the logistics of moving department heads around, that we do police, fire, schools, DPW, and central services, the big five, one after the other, one sitting. We ask NCTV to do it like a regular council meeting with full coverage, and then perhaps we'll get people at that, since it's the big five departments. It's done quickly, it's done all in one night. I mean, it won't be quick, it'd be probably a 2.5 hour meeting, but it would then be well televised, would get all the graphics and everything in it. Even if we don't get, you know, cast of thousands here, we now have a replayable television thing that covers most of the budget, because these are all the departments that spend more than $1 million a year, all in one package. As I said, the mayor and finance director know the budgets probably as well as the department heads do, but we would have our budget books by then, so anybody that had a really esoteric question that they thought maybe the mayor wouldn't know off the top of his head, just submit it to Susan in advance of that meeting and say, hey, I have a question about this little line item over here. If you don't know the answer, would you know for that meeting? Then we have packaged the bulk of the budget from the big departments, done well recorded as a regular council meeting with all the graphics, moving right through everything so that somebody doesn't feel like they have to come back on three different nights and try to catch whatever it is they're looking for. Mm-hmm. I throw it out, you know, not formally, but just something for you to think about, because I'll bring it up on Thursday. But I have been thinking, this has been kind of dragging for a while, how do we package that portion of our budget responsibility in a way that you get a lot of bang for your buck, makes a good presentation for television for being rerun, and maybe gets people to say, you know, I can commit a couple hours to it, but not over three nights, to get people to be here.
So this is an idea you bring up formally
On Thursday.
On Thursday.
But
a little preview today. Yeah.
Yeah, since we're all sitting here, I thought I'd give you some time to think about it.
I appreciate the thought that you put into it. That sounds like a good thing to discuss.
Yeah, because it is hard to make it so people can make a commitment, but at least see the bulk of it without having to come back on a couple different nights. And some of the times we're not even there when it takes multiple nights. Sometimes you're missing counselors for that on this night or that night. We can get one good night, do the bulk of the big departments. That's, you know, from those five, it drops dramatically to the next And then if we want to do more of them than the big five, then we pick them off as we can. And as I recall, really the only thing we're required to do is the public hearing that's held at council.
Yeah.
Those budget, the meetings we do is sort of our due diligence, but it isn't required under the charter. So we can format that any way we want, because it's our due diligence. When the mayor then at the end of that comes to that council meeting in June and presents the thing, that covers the public hearing, because that's what we do at that meeting, is it's a public hearing. So it would cover the charter requirements. This other thing is just for us to ask line item questions.
Do you want any feedback now, or is it something that's
on the agenda? So. No, I just, but I throw it out there so you can be thinking about it,
yeah,
so it's not just dropped on you on Thursday. But
no, thank you.
I have been trying to think of what we can do to make it more user-friendly, more efficient in its use of time, and maybe entice the public to come and, or if not, see it here, have it packed, have it done right, televised, and then be replayed, mm-hmm. so that if people don't get here for it, they can catch it and take advantage of the questions. You know, the insomniacs will be able to watch it for weeks.
All right. So. Well, thank, I look forward to discussing on Thursday for sure.
Yeah.
That's great.
All right. And I'm assuming we'll have, because I missed the last finance meeting where you talked about it, so. And as I understand, the end of it was just to continue it, but we're all together.
Yeah. Thank you.
All right. So that's what I'm going to suggest at any rate.
So you have that CSR thing on the agenda for,
yep.
finance, just so you know.
Mm-hmm.
I published the city council and the finance meeting today.
Oh, okay.
Because I'm not planning on risking life and limb to get here tomorrow. Although I am essential to you.
You're essential?
To you.
Oh, to us.
True.
But sometimes we count, sometimes we don't count.
Why?
I think that's the way the charter feels about us.
Oh, I see. Sorry.
So if you'd like to take a little break, we got about 15 minutes still.
Sure. Okay.
Shall we recess for a moment and
yeah.
take a break, and then we'll
yeah,
reconvene at 5:30 when the rest of everybody gets here.
I move we do that.
Second.
All in favor?
Yeah.
Aye. Okay, we'll be back. So I'm going to call us back in session, the Committee on Legislative Matters of the City Council, and I'll explain to everybody what we're up to here. There are two bodies here. There's the City Council Committee on Legislative Matters, and then there's the Planning Board on this side. And we're holding a joint public hearing on the same issue, because we both have to have public hearings. So to save you having to come twice, we're doing public hearings together. Once the public hearing portion is over with, we're then going to break into our own meetings, and the Planning Board people will discuss what they want to do, and the City Council Legislative Matters Committee people will discuss what they want to do. But that will be after we close the public hearing. So we're going to take testimony together, and then we each have things we need, we each have to do approvals. We'll do that separately. I'm thinking we'll do it tonight, but you never know whether the decision will be made tonight or not. I'm City Councilor David Murphy. I chair the Legislative Matters Committee, and the members are Councilor Scarra, Councilor O'Donnell, Councilor Nash, and Pam is the clerk of our committee. And Carolyn Mish from the Planning Office will be doing the presentations to start each section off. So I'll let her present the section we're working on, and then we'll take public comment from you on each section, because there are three different things we're doing. So she'll present it, and I'm sure you'll recognize the one you're here to comment on. When she's done presenting, then we'll have you come up and comment on that section. And I'll let these are the Planning Board members, I'll let them introduce themselves to you.
Sam Taylor.
Tess Perron Pope. Ann Brooks.
Euripides Oliveira.
Dan Felton.
Mm-hmm. And Tess, you're gonna be the
correct
chairperson.
Be the chair.
So when we split, we'll be doing our thing, and she and her committee will be doing their thing. So I'll start it off by reading actually into the record what the public hearing is for, and what I might ask is for someone from ordinance to move the opening of our public hearing.
To open the public hearing?
Second. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
You guys want to open yours?
Second.
Okay, now we're open. This is on 17.250, an ordinance to add a new smart growth overlay district. An ordinance of the city of Northampton, Massachusetts, providing the code of ordinances, chapter 350-20-20.19, the city of Northampton code of ordinances, to be amended to add a new smart growth overlay district consistent with Mass General Law 40R, amended existing sections as necessary to create clarity. So what I'll ask is for Ms. Mish to present this portion, and then we'll let public comment occur after she does her presentation.
Great, thank you. So Pam, I don't know if you can switch to that. I think my slides are a slightly different order than I think 40R was second, third. This change to the city zoning ordinance is to do two things: expand the district. The slide up, I think, or two slides up. You can go to the first, that one. What you see on the map is in the existing area, which we designate as 40R, which is a designation under state statute. It encompasses a large portion of the state hospital at this time, and it's the only overlay we currently have. It's an additional provision to the zoning on top of the underlying zoning ordinance, and it allows densities of at the state hospital is currently 8 to 21 units per acre. But it allows units to be created in a slightly higher density than what the underlying district might allow. In the Village Hill case, there wasn't really a cap on density, but at the time that the state came up with this provision or this allowance for local governments to adopt 40R, this was an area where we knew we were going to be developing housing, and the 40R district designation was created at the state level to encourage communities around the Commonwealth to develop housing. It's basically a housing incentive program. And as part of the incentive, if you designate the zoning in an area and the state approves your zoning, and then housing is subsequently constructed and occupied under that zoning, the state has a pool of resources to give to the municipality for each unit that's created. And right now, and from the beginning back in 2007 when this was first created, the state's been giving about $5,000 per new unit of housing that's created in a municipality across the Commonwealth. Northampton has taken advantage of that. At Village Hill, we've had some payments, and the payments have gone towards mitigating traffic in particular that in and around the downtown area that is sort of the impact shed, if you will, of that development. So we've also had other projects that have been developed under the 40R at the State Hospital that for which we have not yet received payment, but we anticipate that we will be receiving more payments. The expansion is for the little blue square on the red outline is the central business. So downtown Northampton is in red on the map. So to the east of the red is a little blue square, and that's the expansion area where this proposed zoning change would take place. And it's one parcel because we know that parcel is going to come before the boards for development. It's close to downtown. It meets the criteria under the state requirements for designating such 40R zones. And so we feel like it's a ultimately a win-win situation for the applicant. It's a little bit of an easier process than what would otherwise be required of the applicant to come through the city under another statutorily defined zoning or provision in the zoning. And then the incentive for the city, the win part for the city also, is if we know we're getting these units, the state would potentially reimburse us for those units. So the language, there's a two-part. It's a map change to add this one parcel to the 40R map overlay. And then the rest of it is a text change that goes along with it that designates this almost as a subcategory, because there are different development review criteria that we look at in an area this is Bridge Street, just three parcels down from the post office. So there are different review criteria that we look at there as opposed to at the State Hospital, which has already its own set of design standards. But the design standards incorporated in this 40R are exactly the same design requirements that we currently require in the Urban Residential C District, which is the underlying base. We're just duplicating that text under our 40R section because, frankly, the state recommends that we do it that way, and they're the ones that ultimately will also validate and approve whether or not we can make this change and this expansion. They won't give us any incentive money unless they approve the way we've written it. So what you see in the red line of the text is, and the version that was distributed it contained the entire existing 40R package. I've since scaled that back just to show the areas that are changing. And so there's a little bit of reorganization for the existing text languages, but mostly it's adding a whole new section that just addresses this Bridge Street parcel that would be added in. And it's to clarify what the density would be allowed, a minimum of 20 dwelling units per acre, which is in fact what the state requires in order to apply the 40R overlay. And also to incorporate and clarify that there would be any project that gets built subsequently under this standard would follow the same design criteria that are required of other applications in the Urban Residential C District.
And what's on this parcel now?
There's an existing older home that has 15 more like SRO units. They're all affordable units. The other piece to this 40R is that the units that you have to include affordable housing in these in your zoning allowance, and you have to build affordable units. So this existing structure contains 100% affordable housing units as defined under state and local regulations. And there's a proposal to expand that structure to double the number of units on the property, all again 100% affordable, so it qualifies under the 40R. But that piece, the renovation, will come before the planning board for review. So this part of the conversation is really just about providing the provisions and the regulations to allow this type of development. The actual details of that development will come through just like any other site plan or special permit in front of the planning board. So you guys are making a recommendation about what's gonna happen on the parcel.
Oh, that's their job after the fact. So, any questions from anybody up here for Carolyn first?
And just understand something, that partial, the blue, you'd be integrating the big one? Or it's just be isolated and surrounded by different zones?
It's going to be isolated. It's a separate, it's a separate subzone under the umbrella of 40R. And the way because it's an overlay district, it's treated differently than the baseline district underneath. You couldn't create spots of bits of zoning around the city like that because it would not be consistent with planning efforts. But this is an overlay on top of that baseline zoning, so you're allowed to do that, one, with an overlay, and also particularly with this 40R, you can even frame it around one building. It doesn't even have to contain a whole parcel. That's
and
the
underlying zoning is URC, correct?
Urban Residential C.
Okay. Any questions again from up here for Carolyn before we, you're all good? Any questions for Carolyn before we take public comment? Councilor Nash?
So we have the language here for the overlay, and I'm trying to figure out where the changes are. I mean, have, I mean, the document that was sent to us is, I mean, where within the document is, are the changes, I mean, is that this here, or?
Yes, so there's a red line, you should have received a red line version that had all the changes, but specifically, under the definition of design guidelines, all the urban residential C design guidelines are carried over to the section of design guidelines in the 40R. And then there are, there's a differentiation, so that's the biggest change, is sort of carrying over all the standards for urban residential C into the 40R. And then the other issue would be, the other change is to identify in the section is 20.5, I guess, is distinguishing between the Village Hill 40R and the Bridge Street 40R.
Okay, so my question is so the changes, the document that you have there, I didn't get yet, or?
It should have been sent out.
We got two of the same things, and it wasn't.
I think there was one.
I think maybe you saved over it, because there was something that had two different names, but it was the same content.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
I mean, so this
but
is...
you, but did, Pam, you got the original, when it went to City Council originally?
Well, what I got from, that I sent to City Council originally was what I sent to Alan, and he said that there was something wrong with it.
The numbering was messed up, but that had all, it didn't take the subparagraphs, so it, because it carried over from the one that was codified, but that had, so the one you have there, can I see what you have, Jim? Just
sure.
So you can,
it might be the paper copy one, yeah. Jim. It's just that I think the back side of that document is incorrect. You just, there's 13 pages, and you just have to look at the front side because somehow it copied the one page on the second side.
Okay. So this has the entire context of the 40R, then the changes incorporated, excuse me, into it. And so what's, so we have, so in the zoning, there's a section 20, and it starts out with defining what 40R is. That was all adopted in 2007. Nothing of that is changing. There are definitions of what affordable housing are, affordable homeownership. All of the definitions required under this 40R statutes are there. And then there's a description in 20.3 of the overlay district. And this is where then there's sort of two districts, sub-districts created within 20.3, just adding this parcel and the associated text with it by essentially creating a separate zone, a separate area defined as the Bridge Street 40R. And then it's incorporating all the design changes that go with that. So, but it sounds like you didn't, I need to get you a clean version of it.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Okay. So the other piece of it, just so you know, the state has to review this. They're reviewing it now. And the city council cannot adopt it until they say it's okay. So I don't know when it can actually go on to your schedule. So in the meantime, of course, I mean, tomorrow I can send you the cleaned up version that clarifies those pieces, but
so if we need the time we spoke of earlier, we have it.
Yes,
we can't. Okay. They can't go to council until the state's done.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Councilor Donald, did you have a?
Can I just ask some technical language questions?
Sure.
One, I mean, just to echo what Councilor Nash said, I do think it's important that we get the exact amendments, and I know they're in the document, but that's important for this committee in particular to be able to see some, which I know you know. So. Now, I'm looking at a red line printout, and I see that it seems that the two subzones, A and B, are actually being deleted. Am I wrong? I thought I just heard you say they were adding.
They're reorganized into a separate section. So they're going to act like subzones, but this is because the state said they wanted it in separate sections. So I went back in and created, so there was a section for Village Hill, and then there'll be a section for Bridge Street. So it looks like it's deleting that, but it's really putting it down in the next, well, maybe three sections down in the document.
Okay.
So I'm gonna see if I can actually post this.
Can I?
On the screen.
I'll let you do that.
Yeah, no, go ahead.
Okay. Well, the language thing would be, in the same section it says, sustainable growth overlay district herein referred to as the SD district is an overlay district, et cetera, shown on a map entitled Sustainable Growth Overlay District, and this is dated May, ? 2017, because we don't know.
Right.
I mean, if we're gonna pass language, I'd like it to just be firm language. Could it just say the most recent version of the map entitled Sustainable Growth Overlay District? I just feel a little uncomfortable passing things with question marks. You know what I mean?
Right, and I think that was sort of a placeholder until
we
know it's going to council, and then the day that it goes to council, we can put the date in, or we could do it the language that you suggested.
Yeah, if you're comfortable with that.
Yeah.
Okay. And just another question later on, when it gets into the requirements of what affordable housing has to comply with. And I've seen this come up in some of the meetings that Councilor Nash held in Ward 3 with Valley CDC. There's one part, it reads, for an affordable rental unit, the monthly rent payment, including utilities, parking, et cetera, shall not exceed 30% of the maximum monthly income permissible for the household. And I guess I just wanted to double check that that works for the project that we all know we're talking about. Because I remember in some of these meetings, that number seemed to be one that had some wiggle room built into it based on the policies of the rental policies around the CDC. So I just wanna make sure the 30% figure is okay. Okay. Seems that it is. And just a small thing just for the record, there's a number of, I don't know if this is just a formatting problem, but there, you may wanna do a search and replace for this. There's a number of places where there's the word so, S-O, percentage. I don't know if that's supposed to be 50 or what percentage that's supposed to be.
I think that, I'll do a search and replace. I think that was a problem of the translation from
that's
the,
just like a technology thing. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions from you folks at this point? Planning board? Any other questions at this point? Then we'll go to the public and let's go with the, I hate to break you down into opponents and proponents because some people might only have questions. But let's start off with people that firmly consider themselves proponents. And the first people on my list, the first person is Laura Baker.
Sure. Well, I work at Valley CDC. And so we're supportive of this overlay change. It will allow us to expand an existing property in an existing use. And for us, it's really an alternative to using the comprehensive permit process, which we believe that we could do successfully for this property as well. This is a more expedited process. And so it's good for us in that way. And of course, the city, unlike under comprehensive permit, the city stands to gain financially from using this particular process. We believe it still gives the city some good control through the site plan review process to look at the particulars of the project. So we would urge your support. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I'm happy to answer particulars about the project because we have a lot of information, but I don't know, I'll yield to the chair in terms of what you
Yeah, because this isn't the planning board presentation on a specific process or project, actually not process, but project. So. Mark, do you want to, anything you want to, I know you're engaged with the project.
Right, so I'll make this very quick. My name is Mark Sternick. I'm Vice President of Dietz & Company Architects. I worked on the original 40R, the Village Hill Master Plan, and a lot of the early buildings there, and looking forward to seeing this come to fruition. I think it's a great project to get single room occupancy and close to downtown and all the services.
Thank you. And the last person on my list is Marcia Bloomberg, but I don't know whether you're here to talk about this one or something that we haven't gotten to yet.
Hi, I'm Marcia Bloomberg. I live at 63 Rick Drive, so I think I'm here for the next thing.
Oh, okay.
But I do have some questions since I sat here listening. You had a map up there with a little blue square up in the upper right. Is that the part that you're talking about that's going to be rezoned?
That's the parcel that would be affected.
Do you have the boundaries of that or some map that shows?
Yeah, so the second page, Pam, you want to click down to the second photo. So that's a lighter blue in the upper right is the parcel boundary.
That kind of green rectangle.
So that's on Bridge Street?
Yes.
Before the curve?
Yep.
Next to the Historical Society or whatever?
Yeah, it looks like it's kind of across from what the Coolidge condos.
Okay.
They're across the street.
All right. You mentioned there's a minimum of 20 units. Is there a cap to how many units per acre?
Not in this zone, no.
Okay.
So that would be in the permit application that went to the planning board would define that, I think.
So the underlying zoning doesn't have a cap either?
It does. The overlay allows building to a higher density than what the underlying zoning does. So you couldn't do that density in the urban residential C district.
Well, I don't want to be facetious, but if there's no cap, somebody could put a high rise, or are there other zoning restrictions that
there's
would say
height,
no?
There's height, there's mm-hmm. an open space requirement, so there okay. are other things that control how much you could put on the parcel.
Okay, thank you. I would like to speak again later.
Oh, when we get, thank yeah, you. We're doing three different things, and
yeah.
I know people are here for different, three things in the public hearing, and people hear different parts of it. So is there anyone else on this portion of the meeting, the overlay portion of the meeting? Going once, going twice, I don't hear
any. Proponents now, right?
Right, we'll keep going for anyone else, because I did say proponents, so I don't know if you're opponents, if you just want to comment. Anybody else, any comments at all? On this overlay first item on our agenda. All right, I guess it's safe to say we're done with that one. Then we'll move on to the next one. And this is 17.251, an ordinance to remove the residential incentive overlay from the zoning map 350-3.4. An ordinance of the City of Northampton, Massachusetts, providing that the Code of Ordinances, City of Northampton, Massachusetts, be amended by removing the RI overlay from the map 353.4 of said code to be consistent with the text changes made to eliminate the overlay. So, Carolyn, you want to present this?
Yes. So, a couple of years ago, back in 1991, back up. The city adopted an ordinance that created an incentive for building affordable housing in this area shown in yellow. So it's to the west is, the text maybe isn't showing up so well, but is Route 9 and Look Park and runs the bottom of that map, runs along Bridge Road and then out all the way up to North King Street. And so it's this swath in, outlined in yellow was an area where incentive, if you were to build out four or more acres on your parcel in a cluster fashion, meaning you're grouping the development in an area and permanently protecting the other portion of the parcel, if you opted to allocate 30% of the units that you were creating as affordable under our zoning, then you could, depending on the other constraints, you could potentially get a few more units or a little bit higher density if you followed the requirements under that. A couple of years, so associated with that text in 1991 was a map showing the area where the incentive was created.
We've not had any projects in the 25 to 30 years that that's been on the books that have come in under that provision. At the time, there was excess capacity in the sewer system as well as capacity in the road network. We don't feel like there's that same capacity now, and there are other constraints, environmental constraints that come into play in this portion of the city. So a couple of years ago, when the rural residential and suburban residential and URA districts were rewritten, that incentive in the text part of the code was eliminated. But we didn't at that time eliminate the map portion. So this is just taking the graphic designated on the official zoning map away. So we have to hold a public hearing when we change any map maps, and we also have to notify every single property owner who owns property in the area in which the map is being changed. So they won't really, since we've never had a project under this, it really doesn't affect.
So am I to understand that the actual, when we redid the zoning not that long ago, that the capacity in the underlying zones here for this was removed at that time? The only thing that wasn't changed was the map wasn't changed.
Right.
So what you used to be able to do in this overlay district, you can't do there anymore.
It's not written anywhere in the code.
It's not written anywhere, so you couldn't do it anyway now?
Yeah.
So we're just taking away the, we're taking away the map, defining a district where you can't do what you used to be able, anyway.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Any questions from up here first? No, you guys are all versus counselor.
Can I just ask, I see a section of the code that I think still exists. It's a residential incentive development overlay district.
Mm-hmm.
That's not what you're saying has been removed.
Oh, in the cluster section? There is still a remaining piece of that text, but in the table where where all the definitions of what's allowed and the dimensional requirements were lifted from the table when we went and did the RI. We still have this whole section of cluster that we need to rewrite that includes more than just taking this piece out. So there is that one piece left within cluster that we need to go back and address, but because it's a bigger part of the entire cluster provision, we have that mapped out as being working on together as one section instead of taking bits out.
Okay. So you're gonna go back and probably remove that.
Right.
Okay.
So just to be clear, if I had a parcel there that was big enough to do this, could I come in and apply for it now, or is that not possible?
So you would go to the table of use and it show what's allowed, and we used to have a line for residential incentive overlay and what the dimensional requirements were, and that's all been taken out of the table. So an SR, an RR, an URA, and WSP, that's not there anymore.
All right, so I couldn't come in and submit an application to do what this map implies I used to be able to do.
Right, and it is confusing because we've done this by in piecemeal and bits.
All right. So it is an overlay in which it's no longer possible to do this.
Right, in large part because it doesn't make sense as an area to be encouraging that kind of development because of the capacity issues and the plan, the overall plan for the city, Sustainable Northampton, targets other areas for that type of development and not in this portion.
Okay. Councilor.
But technically, it is possible to do it for a cluster development. If you came, to Councilor Murphy's point, if you came in with a proposal, not saying it's likely or that the market would support it, but technically you could, because that's still in there.
Well, I'm not sure. I think it's arguable because in the table, that you're only allowed to do what's stated in the table of use, and it's no longer in the table of use. It's in the other section under provision of cluster.
Clusters are in the table of use.
Right, open space residential cluster, but not the rural, not the residential incentive cluster.
Okay.
good for questions from up here?
Quick question, has DPW weighed in? I'm assuming they're in agreement that there's...
They haven't weighed in, no.
I mean, I don't know that they need to, I just didn't know if maybe they had shared that they would agree that...
They didn't, no.
Other questions before we go to public comment? And for public comment, Marcia, is this the one that you had
Yes.
come to comment on then?
Thank you.
I appreciate your having us here and letting us know and talk about it, and I appreciate all the volunteer work that you guys do. So I hate to say I'm here to complain, because I know that's kind of a bummer for you guys, but this is all we got in the mail. I didn't even know which one affected us. I mean, I saw the map, but so I knew I was affected in some way by one of these, but there was no other information. Even what you read is more detailed than what is on this notice. And I think there must be a word missing in the description of number three, because I did not know what it meant. This previously adopted text eliminated the provisions previously allowed. Maybe adopted text that eliminated. So it appears to me that this is kind of a meaningless change. It's just a conforming change to take a map out so that there's not a graphic that doesn't conform with what is actually permitted. Is that correct? Okay. So my main point at this point is not to argue about the zoning, since it's water under the bridge, but just to seek more information when a notice of a public hearing is sent out. I mean, the Secretary of State sends you some three paragraphs explaining what you're voting on. It would be helpful. And then you wouldn't have to listen to me, because I probably wouldn't have come. Thank you.
Just a question for you. Since the underlying zoning that supported the map was removed a while ago, do you recall, because that in essence was the big change when the zoning changed. Did you ever get a notice on that?
I don't recall that, but I don't know if that was part of the big rezoning that happened to...
Carolyn, answer that.
Yeah, so the city is required to send out notice when a map change is made to all the property owners, but not when text changes are made. So there's just advertising in the newspaper. So folks wouldn't have gotten a notice about the text changes individually. And we have our phone number and website on the mailing. And we did, I fielded a lot of questions over the phone about that. We did have a description, a more detailed description, because it's kind of a lengthy explanation to make. So that was on our front page of the webpage as well. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so when the substantive change that actually removed the ability to do what the overlay was there for was made, people didn't get notices, but they did get notices when we changed the map, which is sort of like closing the barn door after the horse left.
Well, it does seem that way, yeah.
Okay.
And I feel a little bit nostalgic, because I was among the people who lived in Laurel Park who objected to a plan in the late 80s, I believe, to have extensive development in Cook's Pasture, which is back, is now in the Broadbrook Conservation Area. And I think cluster housing was one of, that included an affordable element was one of the things we advocated for, but to put the housing someplace else, make it affordable so lower income people in Northampton could still live here. We didn't want to just say no housing in Cook's Pasture, but to have this other thing. What you explained is that the area probably couldn't accommodate it now with the infrastructure. Is that what you're saying? So that's my nostalgia. I just want more information when I get something in the mail. Thank you.
All right. Anyone else want to comment pro or con on this that's out in the one that anybody else is here for? I know we're doing three things. Yeah, please come up and just give us your name and address so that we can keep track of you.
Wayne Tebow. 830 Chesterfield Old Florence. I own a property up in North King Street that's going to be changed under this. And I probably did get a notice, but I don't remember getting a notice when it was done. I always thought it was under the rural incentive. I did check with the planning board when I saw this first coming up, and they told me the change was made previous. But with a lot of these, a lot of these zoning changes and everything where they encourage things, I just find it's kind of unfair in ways. I own 33 acres up there, but because I don't have the width, enough width of frontage, I really can't do anything with it. I've even, there's been talk with, I've had talk with the city over the years. Originally, it was going to be donated to the city when they're going to build a condo project up there, but that fell through. And I tried for, asked about flag lot, because I do own frontage in North King Street. I even, like the Broadbrook would like the land, the city would like the land. And even with me offering or asking, if you gave me one building lot, which would take hardly any land, kind of like a trade-off, and add a lot of that land, you know, sell it cheap or donate it, depending on what we worked out, for one building lot. And I've been told that is impossible either. And right now, I own probably the one of the last connecting pieces of the Broad Brook, largest section, which is used and always been used, because I have a trail that goes through there that's over 2,000 feet long. So here I own a large parcel, and according to zoning, even for one single house, I really can't do anything with it. And I think there ought to be a little more consideration. And I don't know how this will affect the future. In other words, with this change, if I bought a house in front, if it went up for sale, then I would have all the frontage, and I could build the cluster development and whatever there. But right now, the way it is, and the way the zoning is and so forth, looks like they had that.
Thank you. Anyone else want to make comment on this issue while it's on the table? Going once, going twice? Very good. All right, then we'll move on to our last item for this public hearing. This is 17.252, an ordinance to clarify the definition of a structure for compliance with setbacks in 350-2.1 of the code. An ordinance of the City of Northampton providing that the Code of Ordinances, City of Northampton, Massachusetts, be amended by clarifying the definition of a structure for compliance with setbacks in 350-2.1 of said code. And this is essentially just codifying existing policy, right?
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
And clarifying so that the expanding, you know, we have new structures in the are being added now, and new questions come up at various times. So this is sort of working with the building commissioner to just identify those things so there aren't any questions when people come in about which setbacks are required for different types of structures that are installed, and then eliminating a couple of things. That one that doesn't make sense because we don't really have wharves in Northampton, and then just taking fence out of that for the determination of, you know, setbacks. So all the red line ones are added, and then the two that are, or three that are taken out.
All right, any questions from legislative members? Any questions from planning board members?
Are we going to be changing and adding wharves back in 10 years?
It's possible, I suppose. We'll take
yeah,
it one
that
step
global
at a
warming
time.
Could have us be beachfront. So no other questions from up here? How about from people here for public comment? Anybody want a question on, have a question or comment on changes to the definition of a structure? Going once, going twice, please.
The red up there, where it's in red, you're adding that?
The underscored red is added, and then the strikeouts are the words coming out of them.
So we're taking out wharves, bin, and fence, and adding the other ones, if I can see it correctly.
Well,
we can come up, please.
I just want to comment. My personal opinion, it's just adding more restrictions on things here when you throw in all those extra things. Where do you stop? Throwing in a tent? That's a structure? I mean, what I read here, is that correct?
Yes, tent is to be added, theoretically.
I don't know. I just think you're going too far, in my opinion. Play structures. And then you get into the amount, 4 feet of unbalanced fill. I don't know. Have to hire a lawyer if you want to put something up today. It seems like I'm going to use that term structure and throw all that in there. It's just my opinion.
Any other counselor?
Well, just to that point, could we explain how this works operationally in the rest of the code? I mean, it's really to protect people's property rights as well, right? So you're not sort of encroaching on people's land with your tents, mm-hmm. for example. I mean, do I have that right?
Right, and there's still interpretation by the bill. So what happens is when someone applies to put something up or puts something up without a permit, right now the building department interprets what constitutes a requirement for a permit. So the term in particular, tent, was put in because there are all types of canopy structures that are being installed for things, and so some people might call that a tent and bring it to the building department and say, this is a tent. This is not meant to be a backyard tent where kids throw up and go sleep in the backyard for overnight. It's really more of a structure.
So the canopy, like something you park a car in that's semi-permanent.
Right, or for example, down at the fairgrounds, they put a canopy structure in that, you know, that's a really large structure. That constitutes a structure. It has to meet setbacks, but it is, I mean, it basically has fabric tent, you know, components over the top of it. So that, in that particular instance, and then there's, the other thing is just clarifying the way the interpretations have been used, and the building commissioner felt like it was important for it to be written down so that it was clear for everyone. So property owners, abutters, to know that, you know, if you're putting a stone wall up, that's not going to be considered a structure, except if you need to have it reinforced with fill of a certain height, then that starts moving into more of a structural component. So that's the reason why what seems to be very detailed information is sort of just codifying the practice and the interpretations that are being made every day or every week by the
Board of Commissioners. Thank you. Councilor Nash.
Yeah, so what's a permanently affixed play structure? I mean, like, is it, I mean, I picture most families like putting that in the setback, like at the back of their yards or the side of their yards.
Yeah. So if you have to put it on, you know, concrete footings that are not, I mean, they're not movable, so you
right.
can't move them around, then that, and if it's over a certain size, then it's going to qualify. But some of those are not big enough to qualify. But there are also tree houses that are put in. I say tree house because it's not really in a tree, but it's a very tall structure next to a tree or something. And there have been situations where the building department qualifies it as a structure, and there's a lot of debate about whether that constitutes, because it's a play structure. And then I think the building code has a whole, has specific interpretation of what constitutes buildings for play structures, and some of these things are exempt. So there's a lot of interwoven language here that's a carryover, you know, that sometimes is interpreted one way under the building code and sometimes differently under zoning, so. You know, that's about as much as I can tell you about place structures because they vary, so.
Yeah, so it was based on something, right? I mean, there are complaints that it's not from the year that they adjust to.
Right.
And I personally, I look at my place, Washington Place, and I was seeing if my neighbor put on all those things, I'd go after him or her. Because the things, I mean, it makes sense to me, on my case, on my property. Those things make sense, so I don't know.
And some of the, most of the, a lot of these things that we were talking about in terms of the detail are considered accessory structures to the main house. So they have much different setbacks, but in some cases they, maybe it's not appropriate for them to be right on the property line. So there needs to be a little bit of space. For in most districts now, it's 4 feet from a lot line. In some of the outlying districts, it's 10 feet. So it's not as much as a house, but or the principal structure that's on the property.
And is this definition generally consistent with what other cities and towns in our area use, or is this very, very different from what we see in other zoning regulations?
I didn't take a peek for these changes. The basic structural definition is consistent. The change was precipitated by sort of a few things that had come up that really needed to be defined more clearly.
So I'm sorry. This structure is for any kind of zoning, specifically for a house or for them?
So,
for
right.
Instance, my
so
place
it says
is
permanent or
housing anywhere, my place. So I don't see this could happen.
Well, so this is a definition in the zoning code, and so we use, then there are a series of, then there are, in the dimensional requirements, it tells you how far from your property line you can put certain structures. So it feeds back to the structure definition. So permanent or temporary occupancy, if it's a home, it's going to be permanent occupancy, whereas a shed is temporary occupancy, considered more accessory.
And I think that makes sense because some fellow can decide to put a business in the backyard and put a little something in the back and start to run some business, and that's not in a residential area. So I think that's what it is.
Question?
Yes, two things I'm wondering. Underground vaults or bunkers, are those covered as a structure?
Interesting. I think shelter is there. It doesn't say whether it's underground or not. I would think that would be interpreted by the building department as a structure because if you're putting, for instance, a foundation. So when you're building a house, you're putting a foundation in, so that's part of the structure. If you were to build something that's below grade, I would think that the building department would, if it were of that sort, would be considered. It depends on how it's designed. And
sure.
It's,
I'm just wondering whether it should be in there or not. And the other question was gasoline pumps, pretty specific. There's diesel pumps, so there's...
Yeah.
You know, biofuel pumps, should it just be fuel pumps and not so specific as a gasoline pump?
I don't think that would harm anything. I think
it's, I'm just curious as to why. I mean, if I was to put in a, I mean, there's so many other regulations that would come into play, it in some ways wouldn't matter. Fire marshal would get far more involved in the building department and where I put my pumps, but it seems like that's a pretty specific thing to include there.
Yeah.
That's been there a while, right?
It's been there a while.
Old-fashioned terminology already.
Yeah. So, I certainly, from my perspective, it wouldn't, it would only broaden it and it wouldn't be detrimental, I don't think.
Any other comment from either those of you up here or the members of the public. Going once, going twice. And as that was the last item of our public hearing, last call, then entertain a motion from Legislative Matters to close a public hearing. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Can I just ask for clarification, just so I, because you, so you, that was for all three items?
For all three items,
okay,
yeah.
Right.
Because we just kept going. Good? All right. So now at this point, the individual bodies can debate what action they want to take on what was covered in the public hearing. Do you want to, now the first thing we dealt with, the smart growth overlay. Since we have some time on that one, do you want to delay that until we get the final version of paperwork? I know you were concerned that the materials we got weren't really, really clear. And we appear to have the time because we have to wait for the state to act anyway. So if you wanted to take the time to get a clearer text version of this, we could do that. Your pleasure.
I don't see any reason to delay the smart growth overlay, the 40R ordinance. The one that I'd be waiting for amendments from would be the removal
of the of that overlay, the map change.
No, actually, no. No, no, you're right. Yeah, no. I don't see any reason to delay the 40R personally.
That's all right, Councilor Nash. I know that you were having some discussion that.
I would like to actually look at a document with the changes, clarify this. I mean, I've done lots of outreach with neighbors, I've spoken to Valley CDC, you know, I'm feeling good about things there, but I just want to be clear about what the specific changes are.
Clear enough to want to continue that one for a while, or?
Yeah, I think so. Good.
Okay.
When's your April meeting?
Second Monday, so the 10th. So that's not going to do any real harm, I assume, because you're not going to.
No, and in fact, it might be better because the state might have given me comments back anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So then you can see that and incorporate that into your discussion on the 10th. So that's no. I mean, I sent an email today just to see where they were in their review, and I didn't hear back. I was expecting to hear back last week and it didn't hear anything, so you know,
that
probably makes sense.
So do you want to move to continue 17.250 till our next meeting?
So another idea could be just do a neutral recommendation to City Council. I'm new to procedure, but that would give us all time to look at the changes, and then, you know, we could do the actual vote with the changes that Council's doing.
Just so you know, it's on your agenda for Thursday for a first reading.
Which won't happen until you hear from the state, correct?
Yeah, I'd like that to be pulled, because you can't act on it, that technically they don't want you to do that, so, yeah.
Okay. So I just had to publish the agenda today, because I'm anticipating I won't be in tomorrow.
Well, we can just continue it.
Yeah.
Because it's too soon for action, so
right.
That's a fixable thing.
Okay,
so
can I have a second on that?
So Councilor Nash, what's your pleasure?
Either one works for me. You know, either the neutral recommendation or we
make a motion and see if it gets seconded.
I'm going to neutral recommendation.
Second.
Perfect.
All right.
Any discussion on that? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Great. Well, you feel free to do your thing.
Oh, okay.
We're doing our own thing over here.
We should probably do it sequentially so I can hear.
Yeah. So what are our thoughts on the overlay district? Do we have thoughts?
No. It's pretty straightforward.
I think it's pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
Agree. And I don't know if you can take 30 seconds or if you want to just remind us that with regard to the specific parcel on this project, that the other option that was mentioned was the comprehensive permit,
right,
which would still result in an application for the same project without any
right
financial benefit to the city, and
right.
So that there is a financial
component that would be beneficial to the city if we were to.
Right, so if they follow, right, if they follow the 40B process, then the same number of units, the same layout, that would be reviewed by the zoning board instead of the planning board.
Right.
And then there wouldn't be that financial incentive.
So pending approval by the state, would someone on our board recommend that city council approve?
I would make the recommendation, city council approve this pending recommendation, state.
Right.
Folks?
Yep.
Got it.
All set?
All set.
And for those in the public, what the committees are voting on is merely a recommendation to council. This still has to go to city council before it actually happens, but it was sent here for our recommendation, so we're just voting on recommendations at this point. So the next one for legislative matters would be the ordinance to remove the residential incentive overlay from the zoning map. Discussion on that one?
It's the yellow one, right?
Yes. I'd move a positive recommendation. Is there a second?
So don't do it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, discussion.
I'm just unclear, this one I'm more unclear on because of, you know, some of the cluster development issues. I'm not sure if we know that, whether you could apply for a cluster development at a greater density. It's like it's kind of a question mark.
Well, if it's not in the table of use, you could only do what's in the table, right?
Right.
So there is nothing in the table related to the residential incentive cluster.
Right.
Like that specific language, correct? So that would be.
I mean, the other piece of it.
Off the table figuratively, literally.
Yeah.
Off the table.
I mean, we could go back and introduce changes to the cluster at the same time as the map if you want to, you know. I mean, it basically, now you remove the graphic on the map so it's not sort of advertising something that's not allowed in the table of use now. Even though there's still a section within the cluster that says, oh, there's this residential incentive. So that's what we were thinking. And then when we come back and make the wholesale changes to the cluster, whole cluster section, then we would clean it up then. I mean, the alternative is just to not do the map now and still have the map showing up with people asking what this means, and then, but still not really having the allowance in the table of use.
But that's been the case for a while, right?
For a couple, probably a year and a half or so,
okay.
2 years.
Okay.
And the table takes precedence over any text.
Right, because
so
if it's not spelled out in the table, then it's not allowed. Yeah.
So with the overlay there, someone might think they could do it and come wanting it, but
right.
It couldn't be done.
Right.
Like they go with the table.
I am a little distressed that we seem to be able to change the underlying zoning and take away uses without mailing the affected parcels. But then we have to mail them when we change the map. So essentially, we can make the uses go away without really telling them about it, legal notice or putting it on the website, and then later say, well, we're changing the map to reflect the fact you can't do that anymore. And I say to myself, as a property owner, why can't I do that anymore? You know, you never notified me.
Right.
That is a little distressing from a citizen point of view, property owner.
I think the big distinction for us, because as a board we see project applications,
mm-hmm.
is that when there is a project and an application for development on a particular parcel, you know, then you'll receive that letter, but that the general change of the zoning language isn't indicative of anything that is or is not happening
at the time,
per se, and so that's why
on your property
notification through those other means, you know, the website, etc., is, you know, is the balance of, you know, the cost and effort of doing individual letters about something that maybe has no impact whatsoever for the next 30 years or so until someone has an actual application.
And this one, it was unique. It had to be over a 4-acre piece.
Right.
I mean, the scenario was such that, you know, the odds of anyone ever taking that letter and having it apply to them would be relatively rare.
It is a balance.
Still, it's a little unsettling that you could change the underlying potential for a piece of property and not tell somebody about it, but then have to tell them later when you're doing the last step of erasing it off the map and their rights are in fact gone and they didn't comment. So
I mean, we notify people differently. So for the text changes, there's wholesale notification for the, and there's public hearing. And then for significant changes, there's a lot of public outreach, not directly mailed to each property owner, but you know, through other means of trying to get people to participate.
I know those legal notices are scintillating reading. Counselor, did you have another?
Well, I'll just say, it's something I may support as city council. I think everyone on that side of the room in their pinkies has more knowledge about zoning than I do, and Carolyn and her tiny small toe has more knowledge of zoning than I do. So for me, this is, it's a little complex, and I just want personally more time to look at it. So it's something, I totally appreciate the reasons being offered to clean it up. Mm-hmm. Totally appreciate this. But I may not support it now, but I'd like some time to look at it. If it advances, I think that's enough time for me to do the,
between now and when
I want to ask.
Yeah, because this one, is this one on our agenda?
It is.
Okay, so the time would be between now and Thursday. It's going to come back.
I won't take forever.
Okay.
Just to explain.
But just remember the council, this is one of those super majority votes because it's zoning. So it needs everybody, almost everybody to go for it.
Yeah, again, I totally appreciate trying to clean up the map, make it reflect.
All right. So any other discussion about the motion? Hearing none, then all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
Okay.
Comments from parents? Ready, go for it.
Go for giving a recommendation?
Yes,
absolutely.
To remove it.
To remove it.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Second?
Yes.
Second. All those in favor?
Yep.
That was quick.
Yep.
Yeah, I like that.
All right, and the last one would be relative to the clarifying the definition of a structure. My only comment would be, couldn't you find a better term than tent? I mean, I have to agree with a member of the public that said tent. I mean,
I agree.
You know, large canvas structure, something, this tent is just really ambiguous. And
could we use canopy with the building department being amenable to canopy?
I guess what I'd rather do is in between now and Thursday, talk with the building commissioner and see if he can come up with a term, because he's the one that suggested some of these structures. So he's the one who sees the stuff and understands which thing it needs to be. Mm-hmm. And I can have it back to Pam for Thursday as a.
Oh, that would be great, because that was my only concern there. I mean, there's a big difference between a tent and a structure like the covered warm-up ring at the fairgrounds that's permanent, and maybe it just refers to its permanent nature.
Yeah, maybe a time component. I mean, I'm just thinking of, you know, I got married in my backyard here. I didn't get a permit for it, but we did put up a tent.
It could have been a pretty big tent.
It was a big tent.
So you can't really say size.
And, you know, it was down and day and a half. And let me tell you that I do know, because I was talking to the people of Northampton Rental, and they were complaining about the fact that in Amherst they have to go through this permit process for a tent, and it drives them insane. So I think that that's correct. And the notion of having to go through a permit for a tent for my wedding would have been one more hassle. I mean, I would probably have doubled it. It was a nice wedding, but you know, something that is going to go down within, you know, within less than a week's, you know, 7 days worth of time would probably be a perfectly good amenable thing to that.
Counselor?
I think that's a good idea, and it makes you wonder. In the first sentence, there is the word temporary. It says combination of materials for permanent or temporary occupancy or use. Should the word temporary be in that? If then we go on to say,
if we talk about permanent structures,
for how long?
What does temporary mean?
Keep on digging up.
And then
I think if you have the construction people giving that term, probably they'll come up with some technical thing that you cannot put on the zoning, right? People will read that. So I think the way I think is that you have the language in the zoning. But nobody can get anything done without the construction, right? Is that right? If they have a permit?
Well, there's some things that don't, I mean, there's some structures that need zoning, but they don't need a building permit, like a shed that's under 200 square feet, that kind of thing. So, I mean, you could say for that one, but it does get to be a problem with temporary, because we have 30-day temporaries.
Yeah.
We have, and so I think tents are probably a little bit different. Maybe you want 2 or 3 days.
It was just an example.
Yeah.
And I mean, we don't want to be ambushed.
Yeah, that's the point.
Yeah, I'm sure the building department can come up with a better term than tent.
I will see, and I will let. I'll pass that on to Pam.
Councilor Nash.
And also, are we going to add in bunkers or
vaults?
Vaults or.
Well, we can't make it more restrictive than what we advertised, correct?
Well,
it depends on whether it's so much more restrictive that it would warrant a re-advertising.
I mean, I don't know, the bunker crowd didn't show up or not.
Right, but it may already have been assumed to be interpreted as a structure, so I don't know that it's really that. Like,
it would
consider so much of a change that it would have to be re-advertised. So, you know, there's that, and I certainly don't think fuel pumps as opposed to gasoline makes any, you know.
No, that, I wouldn't see that as substantive change.
Isn't a tent a framework? The word framework is in here. Doesn't a tent have a framework? It just has a canvas over the framework.
Oh, I see.
I mean, is a tent necessary?
Yep.
Just a thought to ask, maybe the building should answer.
Does that have a structure, right?
I'm sorry?
If you have a frame, you have a structure, right? Kind
of. Yeah, it's totally temporary.
So,
what is our?
Well, I want to know, is the intention to have a permit for an event tent?
No, the idea is that it's whether or not it falls into the category really first of meeting, needing to meet setbacks. So, for example, a fence is taken out of the definition of structure, because then you, if it's a structure, you have to meet certain setbacks, and you don't want fences to have to be set back 10 feet, because then you're essentially giving up 10 feet of your property to your neighbor. But there are other structures that are occupied temporarily or permanently where it makes sense to have a little room. So if you have a shed or a workshop, you want it a little set back. Same thing for a tent. If you're gonna be having an event, maybe it's not appropriate to have your event tent right up to the property line. Maybe it is, but you know, depending on the size or how long it's there.
So you could build your fence in a square and throw a tarp over it?
Exactly.
Yeah.
But sort of getting back to the building permit part, there is a definition in the building about whether or not you need to go to the next step, and that's based on size and type of construction and that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So it's relevant both for permits and for complaints. So if someone erects something without a permit and an abutter were to complain, the building department needs to be able to say, you have a valid complaint because we consider this
exactly
a structure where you don't.
And tent is already in here and has been. Right?
Yes, yeah, tent's already been
tent
in there. It's part of it. It's not a new word.
Tent was an addition, or was it in there?
It was in there.
It's
in there.
Red.
It's been in there?
Yeah.
It wasn't in red.
Yeah, tent's already part of it.
Yeah.
Look at that. So. We're arguing about settled regulation. Hey,
but you are opening it up again, so.
Don't bring up
houses. Legislative matters, folks. Are you inclined to recognize the counselor from Ward 6 that would like to make a comment?
Sure.
Councilor LaBarge, I have to agree with the resident on the issue about tents. If you also look on the stormwater utility fee, people get charged when you have a canvas tent, and you have to pay that stormwater fee. I don't know if a lot of residents in this city actually know that this is added on for that purpose of going through a building inspector when we've had tents in the city. I have people in Ward 6 who use them for storage of wood or whatever. So I'm a little concerned here that if somebody goes out and gets another tent, all of a sudden they're being told, well, you gotta get a permit for that. when you've never had to do that. So I have a little concerns here, because you're still being paid to the city for a stormwater utility fee because of it being impervious versus pervious. So, but that's my concern, is that, which the counselor also had concerns before, I have concerns with a couple of other zoning things.
So is it acceptable that the building commissioner will review the tent concept before we see this again?
Yes.
Yes.
So on this one, do we have a motion?
No.
Do we want a motion?
The urgency on this matter. Okay, so we could continue this.
Sure.
And so that was also on your agenda.
This is also on our agenda for Thursday, but we could.
Or do we want to make specific?
Do we think we need an answer?
We can.
Do we think we need an answer for Thursday?
Yeah, you want to just send it without a recommendation? And
I move a neutral recommendation.
Second.
Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye. What is a neutral recommendation? Does that mean delay?
No, it just means that all we're doing here is recommending. We either recommend it to council positively, we say negatively, or we say we have no neutral. And this all comes up again, and we debate it all again at council anyway. It's just a preliminary thing. So.
And it's separate and apart from our making a positive recommendation to you to approve it.
Right.
Because yeah. You've already decided.
That goes into the final recommendation.
Right. For the council to consider, but, and we do, I mean, because this is really your bailiwick, it is important what you say, probably more than what we say, because we just open the can of worms and go at it all again at council anyway. But what you have to say has some importance to
us. So, Carolyn, do we need to make any motion about this language, knowing that the building inspector will be revising it?
Yeah, I mean, you could just make a recommendation to move the changes as presented if you have, if you want to make a comment about a tent being bothersome to you, you can. Or if it's not enough to rise to that, you can just move it forward with no changes. Or if there's something else that you would recommend, like changing gasoline to fuel or something like that,
you can do that motion for us.
I would recommend that we change gasoline to fuel because I think that's more contemporary and appropriate.
A second?
Second.
Yeah. I still call that.
Those in favor?
All right. So for us legislative folks, is there any new business that was not anticipated? Are we good with you?
Yep.
She says it's okay to adjourn if you so wish.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.